I first became aware of circumcision when I was studying abroad in London, and I had heard about circumcision before, but I didn't really understand what it fully was until I was with some English friends of mine. They asked me why do Americans circumcise, and I had no good answer for them. So he then told me that you're less sensitive because you're circumcised, and this really struck a chord with me. I was really disturbed by this. By the prospect that I'm less sensitive sexually because of something my parents did. So I went back to my dorm and went online and did research on circumcision, and it turned out that the foreskin actually had a lot of erogenous tissue there, and that it made complete sense that if I didn't have this tissue that I'm going to be less sensitive sexually. And you know, it just was mind-boggling that this had happened to me, that my parents had done this to me. My culture would allow this to happen to me in this world that we think is so fair and just. And well, you know, sometimes we think that it's fair and just, but for something as simple as your body, it doesn't seem to be the case. My feelings when I understood what circumcision was shock and disappointment and hopelessness that I couldn't undo something that was out of my hands, was beyond something. I couldn't go back in time and change that. So I was really upset and really devastated, and I wanted to confront my parents, especially my mother, who she had a very naturalistic kind of way of parenting, or at least she pretended that she did. You know, she once commented to me that putting holes in your body was a mutilation, and if putting a hole in your body is mutilation, then what is circumcision? I mean, that's beyond, it's a grotesque mutilation. And with my father was a doctor, so I kind of, you know, and I kind of understood that he probably would have the opinion that circumcision was a necessary thing because he was a doctor in New York City and whatnot, but I also wasn't as close to him as I was to my mother. When I told my mother I was upset about having been circumcised, she initially told me that I was being too sensitive, I was being ridiculous, as being self-indulgent, and she just didn't take it seriously and told me I should have another problem, you know, that will be just as great as this in a month, and this will be, I've forgotten about this. Now, mind you, I didn't speak to my mother about circumcision for about 4 or 5 years after I was really upset about it. So it definitely was not something I took lightly to speak with her about. And it took a few conversations over a period of time, and eventually showing her the movie Cuts, Slicing Through the Myths of Circumcision, that watching that with her, and I think she really understood the gravity of what it was I was upset at with her about, what circumcision really was. And it took her a while to come around to apologizing. She's not a person who apologizes very easily for anything, let alone something as big as this. She likes to think that she's, I don't want to say perfect, but as close to perfect as any human can be. So to have done this to make such a mistake I think she understood that it was wrong, and she feels bad about it, and she says if she could go back in time, she would change what was done to me, what she allowed to have done to me. Circumcising men in Africa to prevent the spread of HIV. I think this is an absurd claim to make, and a dangerous one, that to tell people that circumcision is going to have a protecting effect from HIV. I mean, female to male transmission, which is what circumcision is supposedly supposed to help prevent, it's the lowest level of transmission in a sexual act. HIV is much more readily transmitted through homosexual sex and male to female transmission, not female to male. It's the bottom of the totem pole. You know, it's absurd. Even if it does offer the benefits, I think up to like 60%, they say. I mean, it would be. I think I've read somewhere based on those numbers and, you know, the risk of transmitting HIV in this direction from female to male. I think you have to circumcise 15,000 men to prevent one case of HIV. So I mean, it's just you know, a crazy, desperate attempt to do something in Africa, and probably maybe even on a more sinister scale, to make circumcision still, you know, a respectable thing to do to people in this country, around the world, anywhere, anybody, to protect the rights of a parent, which I don't think are really their rights, but, you know, to protect a parent's right to culturally indoctrinate their child through a surgical procedure. So we went to his speech and with a bunch of intactivists from New York, and in the middle of his conversation with his daughter, his daughter Chelsea was there, and an actor, were on stage discussing the multiple humanitarian efforts that they have, one of which was the campaign to end HIV in Africa and circumcise them. We got up and we're screaming, stop circumcision. Circumcision doesn't prevent HIV. We were chanting this over and over and over, and the crowd started booing us, which was actually really crushing to hear all these people booing us. And Clinton, you know, cited something from a statistic from one of the studies, one of the Ugandan studies, and Chelsea said, you know, what did she say? Oh, it's better for men, you know, something very, you know, unknowing of the situation, just kind of, it was aggravating. But then, you know, the more we chanted, the more I looked around at the guys who were there, and I realized, okay, you know, we may not be particularly popular in the mainstream, but, you know, who the hell cares? Like, this is the right thing to do, and in 50 years, you know, maybe less, hopefully less, people will look back and be like, I can't believe you had to go up and tell people not to circumcise people, because this is horrible, this is wrong. This is wrong as cutting a girl's genitals, as you know, any kind of unnecessary surgery that removes body parts, and it's just wrong.